The average raindrop falls at a rate of how many feet per second? And well,
is this like it's like a physics question?
Yeah, it's like a numbers question too.
Because I know there's like terminal velocity,
right?
And that's probably what the answer is.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't remember what number that is.
Yeah,
so I'm gonna go like 19 feet.
Actually.
That was extremely close.
It was 21 feet per second.
That was pretty close.
Crazy close. Damn, didn't even give me a time to plug the Patreon. I thought I was going to have that space, but you were like, let's answer this.
Now you should plug the Patreon. We do have a Patreon.
That is true. We wanted to thank the patrons before we get into today's episode. Head on over to patreon.com/carscast to get tons of cool perks. And that's it. Keep it brief. More on that later is what we'll say. More on that at the end of the episode.
At some point, yeah.
Yeah. Jeff, what I was going to tell you right before we hopped on was that, and this is not a call for concern, but my throat's a little itchy. And it's because I ate an apple. And I've always thought I was allergic to apples. But the doctor was like, no, it's like one of those things where it like irritates your throat, but you're not fully allergic. You're, like, you're not going to die. And recently, I've just been like, whatever. I'm going to have an apple. And now I'm irritated.
Yeah. So you thought, I am about to record a podcast. The like one thing I do a week where talking is like important for this period of time. So I'm going to eat an apple and irritate that throat.
Yeah. Yeah. Let's really make this a challenge.
Yeah. It's up in the difficulty level of this podcast.
Yeah. Well, I got my water next to me. So, you know, really chase that itch with
some refreshing water,
some glug glug glug. Yeah, anyways, that's what I was gonna bring up. But Jeff, how has your how's your week been since?
Yeah, it's been okay, you know.
We had actual Thanksgiving stuff. I feel like that oh, we talked about Thanksgiving before, but now it's actual.
We did
Thanksgiving.
Yeah,
has
had
passed.
The sweet potato thing. Yeah. That was good.
Yep, that's awesome.
Yeah, I don't really like turkey, so I ate like a little bit of turkey, but
turkey is overrated, I feel like I've come to learn.
I don't think it is, because no one ever eats it besides Thanksgiving.
That's true. I mean, people get sandwiches with turkey.
Right, but I mean, like, no one eats like straight up like chunks of turkey.
Yeah. Yeah.
Cuz it's not overrated. It's just like a ceremonial thing. And everyone agrees that it's not very good. So we never eat it like that otherwise. Yeah,
but we have to do it for Thanksgiving every year.
Yeah.
For no goddamn reason.
We have to kill birds.
Exactly.
It's a ruin the holidays. Like you gotta just murder tons of birds.
Have you ever, maybe this isn't the question to ask. Have you ever gone hunting, Jeff?
No, I've never held a gun.
Really? Wow. Yeah. The thing, I've also never gone hunting. My family, well, at least my mom is like really against it, and as am I. I've just never, I do not get that urge to kill an animal, you know. I don't have that.
I like how you're saying that for people who hunt, it's an urge.
Yeah, it's like, I don't have like, that.
Oh, I gotta do it.
I don't chase that energy. But
it's not a deer, it's gonna be a person.
It's gonna be a bird, and then we're gonna have a delicious feast. Yeah, but I have held a gun before, though. I went trap shooting with my uncles and cousins one year after Thanksgiving and was decent at it. And my cousins and I were really into like airsoft, wars.
Okay. That doesn't count though.
That doesn't count. Those aren't real guns.
That's not a gun,
but
yeah, I've held an airsoft gun.
Airsoft guns are fun.
I did it. I actually did the airsoft gun fighting thing where people have teams and you just run around.
Yeah,
I did that one time ever in someone's giant yard.
Yeah, and it hurts. Really hurts getting hit.
And
by
you better
pellet.
Wear like safety glasses or goggles.
Well, that's what happened is we were playing with my sister, and I think someone accidentally shot her in the cheek, which is such a bad place to have that happen. Because they're
better than the eye, though.
Better that she was. I don't even think she was wearing glasses, but like, thank God she, you know.
Yeah.
Anyway, good times. I mean, not for her, but
for you. It's great.
Yeah, I had a lot of fun. We just have like such a good yard because I live on a farm and like there's just abandoned barns around and like we just crawl in those and hide. And
that actually does sound like a
cool. was a good ass time. I'm not gonna lie.
And then if you didn't want to get shot, you could hide behind farm animals.
Exactly. Well, that's not where I thought you were gonna go.
You hide behind a sheep and you're just like, don't shoot.
Sheep baas. I'm like, no. Yeah. Anyway, enough gun talk on the movie podcast.
Karstcast, guncast.
Yeah, now that we got our gun chat out of the way.
What's your favorite gun?
I couldn't even name a gun. I can't, like...
Desert Eagle, that's
If you
one,
had a
right?
gun to my head, I wouldn't be able to name a gun.
Unless you read the name of
I know,
that
I'd
gun
be like,
on
what,
the gun.
So wait, what's that one? Yeah. I already asked how your week went. Not a lot in the news. Actually, I'm like really, I think I've mentioned this before on the podcast, but I've been off social media and so I don't really know what's
going on. You
don't
know any of the news.
I don't know what's going on in the world, to be honest.
Yeah.
Besides,
you've been on Letterboxd though, right?
That's all I have. I'm on Letterboxd a little too much because like that itch that you have to open Twitter has now been replaced with just opening Letterboxd, and I'm like, well, no one's watched anything in the last 4 hours, I guess.
And there's no DMs either.
No, oh, thank God. You were the one that sent me that weird thread.
I found some thread that was like responding to some Letterboxd tweet, and it was just this guy who went on this long rant about how Letterboxd should have DMs.
Yeah,
and he wanted it so he could hook up with people.
For their film tastes.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, not a fan. But anyway, that's about it. We might as well get into the movie if there's nothing else to talk about.
Yeah. I'm fine with that.
All right.
I mean,
well, today,
why we're here.
We are here to talk about King Richard. This is a new film. It's fresh, a big Oscar buzz surrounding this. I'm sure we'll talk a little bit about that. It's directed by Reynaldo Marcus Green. Yeah, stars Will Smith, obviously. And the synopsis reads, armed with a clear vision and brazen 78-page plan, Richard Williams is determined to write his two daughters, Venus and Serena, into history. Training on tennis courts in Compton, California, Richard shapes the girls' unyielding commitment and keen intuition. Together, the Williams family defies seemingly insurmountable odds and prevailing expectations laid before them. That's a really thorough synopsis right there. That's,
right.
They get into all of it. Apparently, Reynaldo Marcus Green is going to make a Bob Marley biopic next. So that's exciting.
There you go.
Yeah. Anyways.
So have you ever been to a tennis match in person?
I haven't. I haven't.
Did you play tennis growing up?
I did lessons briefly, yes. And we did them in like gym class, but what about you?
Yeah, I played a pretty good amount of tennis from like the age of probably like 6 to 12.
Wow.
I like near the end of me playing tennis and doing lessons, I did some practices at this like facility that was kind of close to where my parents lived, but there were some players who were like in my age group ranked in the state of Florida. So they just would destroy me.
Yeah.
But I did on the first serve ever against one of those players who was like in the top 100 for the age group in Florida, I aced him.
Wow.
And it's because I served it so slow that he was standing too far back and it bounced twice.
you play tennis like it's a mind game, you know. You're kind of...
No, I was really good at running around the court really fast and like hitting the ball back. But I wasn't good at hitting it with power or serving.
Mm. I was going to say that you're 50% of the way there if you can do those two things.
No, defensively, but... I was amazing. Like, people could never like win the point. It would just last forever. Because I could never win the point, and they could never win the point.
Maybe we become like a doubles team, you and I.
Yeah.
And
Last time I played doubles, I hit the person, when I was serving, I hit them in the back of the head. You know, because they have to like crouch down the net.
Yeah.
And I hit them. I hit them. In the head.
They're just like focused, and then they're like,
yeah. Yeah. Because there's a lot of trust that the person that you're playing with won't do that. And I did
and
that.
And you lost all that trust.
Yeah.
I never pegged you for a tennis player.
Yeah. No, I, you know, Florida, it's a thing to do. Like, that's why in this movie, they all moved to Florida to play tennis.
That's true.
Everyone
that
in
is
Florida
true.
Plays tennis.
Oh my God. I didn't even think. Usually, anytime we watch a movie and Florida comes up, I'm like, well, we're talking about it. We're talking about Florida. But this time, it just went over my head.
Yeah, I had a few years also where I also went to some tennis tournaments. Not playing, like watching.
Just watched. Yeah.
So like real tournaments. So like I went to, in Miami, there was one that was like the Sony Ericsson Open. I saw Serena Williams play in that in 2008.
Did she do well?
I don't remember. Probably though. This is 2008, so.
Yeah.
It's kind of like prime Serena Williams.
I think like Wimbledon was going on while I was in Paris. Or...
Yeah. Now, notably, that's not in France.
Okay.
you're thinking of the French Open, which is in
the
France.
The French Open.
Yeah. Wimbledon. Wimbledon's in London. or in England, maybe
that
outside
makes,
of London.
That makes a little bit more sense. Yeah.
Yeah. So the French Open's in France.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I did go to the U.S. Open, like in 2010, I think.
Yeah. As soon as
and
I
you know where that is,
that's the U.S. Open.
It's in New York. Yeah, it's in the U.S.
Yes, okay.
Much like the French Opens in France, but it's in a place outside of New York City called Flushing Meadows.
Their plumbing system must be insane.
Yeah, it sounds terrible. Know? Just sounds like a swamp.
That's awesome. I wonder if there's a lot of casinos there because flush.
Like flushing money?
I don't know. Well, no, you know, like when you, like,
play like good, flush with money.
Flush the car. Like
like a flush in poker.
Yeah, you're like, that's a flush.
Yeah, that was actually the third, like, connection I made was that.
Yeah. I don't know why it was one of the first connections I made. Anyway, this movie. So you have, like, some connection to tennis. So
yeah,
I feel like, you know, you've had some connection here. With the characters.
Well, I mean, I also am older than you, so I kind of remember a lot more of their careers.
Yeah. I will come out and say that I mean, like I said, I did like tennis lessons, never actually competed, and never watched tennis really. Obviously know who like Venus and Serena Williams are because they're like household names, like whatever. But This was all very new to me, so that's my disclaimer.
So you didn't know that much about, like, their origin story?
No. I did not know who King Richard was.
Yeah, I didn't know that much about this either.
King Richard.
And I also really didn't know that much about the film going in, and I was not prepared for the fact that this film focuses on such a short period of time.
Yeah. Yeah,
I would have thought there was like more career stuff, but I mean, I guess this makes sense because there's not that much drama when they just win everything all the time.
Right. It's pretty famously known that they win all the time.
Yeah, and also, but I just thought that maybe they would have gotten more into the Serena part instead of just being like, "Yeah, Serena also plays tennis, and she's gonna be even better." And then they, you barely ever see Serena play like one point of a match in the entire film.
That's true. Well, in general, I was like, I get that it's called King Richard. It's about King Richard.
Yeah.
But I was like, I really wish we could have spent more time on Venus and Serena and like their, not like professional careers, but like just their take on their like younger years, but I understand that would have been weird and like kind of, I don't know, that's like hard to do.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'm like just right down the middle on this movie. I don't know how you feel, but I was like, okay, well, actually, I was going to bring up another point earlier, but I thought they were going to get later into their careers because this thing is like 2.5 hours long.
Yeah.
And I was like, okay, so this is going to be like a life story. And it just isn't. It's like,
yeah,
it really is just stretching out this period of time.
Yeah, I'm so used to seeing biopics where the arc of it is like they start getting success in the first act. I think it's because there's been so many musical biopics. Like, I watched Bohemian Rhapsody not that long ago, and that's, like, you know, the same thing with the Elton John one where...
Yeah.
And the first act is, like, when they're like, oh, here's the struggles, and then it's, like, they get really famous, like, you know, 30, 40 minutes into the movie, and then they're famous for a bit, and then, like, something goes really bad, and then at the end they, like, redeem themselves.
They bounce back, yeah.
And this... They literally didn't have success in this film until the very end.
No. No. Which makes you think, oh, this will probably be, like, a careful like character study or something, like a different take on the biopic. But honestly, this is like one of the most crowd pleasing, generic, just normal movies, which isn't a bad thing. I'm like, that's what this movie set out to do. And you know, that's what we got.
Yeah. The thing is, like, it makes me wonder the extent to which it's based on real life.
Mm-hmm.
Just because it's the way they infuse drama into this film is solely on Richard's choices. So you have to wonder contextually in real life, you know, did people really treat his choices in the same way this film treated him, where they're like, you're crazy, this is never going to work, you're ruining the careers. Yeah. Like, I really wonder how much people said that.
Right.
Because it really seems like they were just so good that they were kind of going to be fine regardless.
Yeah.
After a certain point, like after they got some training, like it seemed like they would be superstars regardless, and it would just maybe take a little bit longer or something.
Exactly. I mean, that is the thing. And I did do like brief research on King Richard. And I mean, he's like gotten himself in a lot of shit, like even past when this film takes place. Like, he just seems like a weird man. But yeah, I think that's a good point. Like, how much of it... It does feel like it's kind of pulling teeth to set up
dramatic tension. That's what I was getting at, where the dramatic tension is really barely in the form of on-court results. It really is just all how people are reacting to Richard's choices.
Yeah.
It's not even those choices being, at least to an audience, like, obviously wrong.
Yeah.
It's just that he says something, and then all the characters are like, that's crazy, that's so wrong, this is never going to work, man.
You also have to wonder...
And then you just have to believe that as the audience. You have to be like, well, he says it's crazy, even though like it didn't sound that crazy to me. But this guy says it's crazy, so this must be crazy.
You also have to wonder, I guess... I mean, I looked this up, and like Venus and Serena approved of this and gave it like the thumbs up and all that.
It felt very much like the classic biopic where the subjects of it have a ton of control, and it feels like it's telling the most... milquetoast version
exactly
imaginable of their story, because Venus and Serena, it just seems like this like idyllic, like, oh, we're like cool children, everything's great,
right?
Like, you know, it makes them look as good as possible, which again, they're children in this film. I'm not saying that they should look bad. I want to be clear. But I just mean like the story it tells is like the way you would write it in like a fairy tale.
Totally. Which is like, maybe that's, like I said earlier, maybe that's, like, what the film set out to do. It just seems, it is, like, such a sports drama biopic, where it's, like, you know how it's going to end before you even watch the movie, especially because it's based on real life. It's just, like, it had so many uphills to climb and decided not to even, like, go against them and just kind of accepted what it's going to be.
Yeah, and if as an audience we accept it in that same way, I mean, I'm with you, where it's very watchable. And it's one of those things where just the subject matter is good enough to, like, kind of carry the film, because even though we know where it's going, it's like, I want to watch it happen. The thing is I still wish it was more about the actual tennis, even though obviously the story of this film is about Richard. So it's a weird biopic because it's about the father of the two people that are famous.
Which
is an interesting take. I mean, you know, I think there probably would be a lot of subjects where their fathers, like, and their upbringing would be a really interesting biopic.
Yeah, or just the coaches. But yeah. I guess coaches are different than the parents. I want to see a Michael Phelps thing. I think that would be very interesting. And I could play Michael Phelps.
He smokes, he smokes weed and then Subway drops him as a sponsor.
Actually, forget that. I don't want a Michael Phelps one. I want a Ryan Lochte one.
A Ryan Lochte. I love how for you, like, swimming or swimmers are like superstars. Like, the swimmers when you were in high school were the superstars.
They were my Venus and Serena, Ryan and Michael Phelps.
Ryan Lochte, I just love how dumb he comes across in every interview.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, he doesn't even like pretend. He really just goes all out. And honestly, he's a butterfly guy. Like, he was my idol in high school. Cause I was like, oh, he's so cool. He's so dumb.
Back to the film.
Movie's about.
Okay. And this is a minor spoiler. It's fairly early in the film.
Okay.
There's a murder scene.
Yeah. Yeah.
That murder scene was kind of funny to me.
It was. In what way?
Okay, so yeah, you're definitely gonna need like the spoiler warning before this section.
I don't know.
It's pretty early in the film, but anyways, skip the next minute if you don't want to hear this.
Yeah, yeah.
So Richard's gonna like murder this guy is the insinuation. He takes a gun. He's walking towards the guy, and right before he walks the guy, there's just a drive by, and the guy just gets like killed immediately. And then they cut back to Richard. And Richard's like,
yeah,
and then he just walks back to his car. Like, I know the insinuation of the scene is like, oh, Richard almost made a big mistake that would have ruined everything.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's like, luckily, the guy got killed still right died. Before he tried to kill
him. Yeah. And the luckily, there was still a murder.
Yeah, the movie treats it like, well, good thing those guys got to him first.
Yeah.
You and saved Richard's my life like, oh. And then he just gets in his car and, like, drives away. Just a really awkward scene.
Yeah. Yeah. Richard, I'm just like, I think maybe that's it. I just can't really take him that seriously, and maybe that's on Will Smith, but he's just like, just kind of like prances around. And
he doesn't feel like a real person.
Definitely doesn't feel like a real, feels, okay, let's talk about that.
Yeah.
Because Will Smith gives a pretty good performance here, but it's also like so, it honestly embodies a lot of my issues with like modern day impressions and whatnot, where it's like they get the mannerisms and like can, you know, nail the voice and the body movement, but I'm like, you don't feel like a person. You feel like you're acting all the time. Yeah. And I was like,
the voice he does the whole time.
Yeah. I'm just like, I'm not there yet.
Yeah.
And I think that's why I never felt fully like connected in this movie, because it's like, it wants you to think Will Smith's a great actor more than it wants you to believe in this character.
I agree with that. And I don't, the voice he does, I feel like is distracting more than anything. Even if the guy's voice sounds like that, we all know this is a movie, and we know that Will Smith is doing a very specific voice constantly.
Yeah, yeah.
That's the issue I have, right? Like, if this was some actor that no one's ever heard of doing that voice, I think it would be easier to accept.
Yeah,
I think it would be easier to accept because we wouldn't be so ingrained to know what Will Smith sounds like. And Will Smith is just doing this voice where it's kind of a lispy, like, voice.
Yeah, yeah.
The entire movie.
Right. I agree.
I don't know. It's hard for me to get over. Some people might be like, no, that's great acting. I totally believe that's what Will Smith sounded like.
Well, the thing is, it's like, it's about to get an insane, now we're drifting into another topic, but it's getting an insane amount of award love. Like, this is just gonna get eaten up. And people are saying, like, Will Smith's the front runner for best actor. And I'm like, I just don't know if that's the case.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's a feel good story. Yeah. I think this is actually in the same mold as, like, Trial of the Chicago 7.
Yeah. No.
In terms of why it's, like, getting a word buzz.
Mm-hmm.
It's fine, but it's just, it has not, it's not really saying anything new.
Mm-hmm.
It's just telling, like, a, you know, a story that kind of feels relevant right now.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's very fine, much, but it's not great.
Yeah. It's kind of the Oscar baity movie of the year so far. Like, which is, again, there's Oscar bait movies that are just really fun and good to watch, but this one, I definitely felt very little while watching it. My main takeaways are, like, what I got out of this was not Will Smith, but whoever played Brandy Williams, the mom, Anjanou Ellis. I've never seen her in anything else, I don't think. She was great.
Yeah, she was great. I think she
really liked
her
performance.
The best performance in this.
Absolutely. And I'm like, it's well acted. It's not the best thing in the world, but it's like, they clearly are really committing here.
Yeah, I always forget the name of the guy who was the final coach with the mustache, and he was in, like, The Walking Dead.
Oh, yeah, he was in Baby Driver. Yeah. John Bernthal.
Oh, right. Yeah, but his performance was, I don't know, it was a little bit, like, it
weird.
Felt out of place. Yeah, it felt like this was a comedy with his performance.
Yeah, he's just not that kind of actor.
He was doing, like a Ted Lasso impression.
Yeah. Literally. Yeah, I don't know. It was. I mean, I really liked the look of it too. It had, like, this sunny California, Florida thing, like throughout the whole movie, and I thought it looked pretty beautiful.
No, as a period piece, I loved, like, the costumes. Like, the '90s is finally becoming old enough to where
it's a period.
Where period pieces are, like, you know, I have my earliest memories are of people, like, dressing like that.
Yeah. You know what? I'm going to let you take the wheel for a second because I need to plug in my laptop.
Okay, Carson's plugging in his laptop. I'm just going to give you the play-by-play. He's wearing if you're listening to the audio of this podcast, he's wearing a Chicago Cubs hat, which, big Cubs fan, Carson. If you want to know anything about him, start there. Whenever you see him in person, just say, "Go Cubs, go," and then Carson will reply with, "I love the Cubs." And then, so the thing, he's getting back, he's sitting down, so I'm going to pretend I'm talking about the film. And the thing with Will Smith's performance, you know, like, Will Smith's performance was okay. And that's, I think, where we have to you know.
What did you talk about that whole
discussion?
Time?
I was talking about Will Smith's performance.
Okay. I thought it would be so funny if you just talked about something completely different. And then as soon as I put the headphones in, you were like, and Will Smith's performance was.
Yeah. I mean, the thing is, like, you know, what if I said something, like, crazy?
I know.
And then you wouldn't find out until you listen back to it. And that's if you listen to it.
Which is a rare case.
Yeah.
I don't know if you noticed, I have my TV on, which is just a big light just booming on the.
That's kind of cool, though. Is it, like, I saw, like, green on the far wall.
Yeah, pretty fancy.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Okay, what did you think about the performances of all of the children?
They were, you know, they weren't bad until you kind of noticed. And a lot of them, like, really owned their line. Like, you could tell they rehearsed it for weeks and then kind of just, like, gave it their all in the moment and it stood out.
I feel like they were given such difficult roles.
Yeah.
Because they were like, okay, so you're a tennis player. This movie's not about you. You're kind of like side characters.
Yeah.
But also, whenever you talk, you have to pretend to be the most confident tennis player that's ever lived.
Exactly.
And the thing is, their acting is like, they're acting as if they're saying lines that were rehearsed.
Yeah.
But deliberately, because the point is that their father trained them to talk to the media, and most of their lines are to the media.
Yeah, yeah. Which is like, there's layers to this, you know?
Yeah, it's a lot of layers, and it kind of feels a little bit imbalanced. It didn't bother me that much, though, because it's not...
No.
It's just a... odd. I don't know. This movie is just slightly odd for me.
It's a little off.
The tone of it, I think it's tone is the issue I had, is that it felt like the tone should have been slightly more dramatic, and it wasn't.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know? What? Oh. Like, well, I was just talking about, you know, how in, for instance, another Will Smith film, because we're talking about Will Smith, and also for some reason this is the first thing I thought of to compare it to, The Pursuit of Happiness.
Oh. Thought you were going to say Hitch.
I could have said Hitch. But I just mean, in The Pursuit of Happiness, right, in the arc of this film, the sense of stakes worked a lot better for me, and that you're like, okay, like, their life could be ruined. But in this, it just felt like any sense of stakes were just like small bumps, and regardless, it was going to shoot to the top.
Yeah. It's trying more to, like, make sense of how Serena and Venus came to be, rather than telling, like, a story. I don't know. I don't know if there's a
difference,
but...
You know, that they didn't care about making, like, everyone knows the ending already.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I don't know. But as an audience, obviously, stakes is a pretty important factor in making you care.
Right. I think this is, like, at the end, like, the purpose that this would serve on a bigger scale is that, like, I'm sure, like, if there's, like, young girls who are, like, wanting to be athletes, they'll get a lot out of this, and, like, it's very inspiring, and probably it's just, like, a good family watch. It's, like, no wonder it came out Thanksgiving
it's
week.
Like, Finch.
It's just like Finch, yeah.
It's just like
in case
Finch.
We ever,
I mean,
get in an apocalypse, and, you know, we gotta build Jeff.
Yeah. I have a question.
Okay.
If you were in the Finch apocalypse, would you rather have, like, you can only pick one of the people in this film to spend the apocalypse with?
Wait.
If we were in the Finch apocalypse.
If we were in the, are you saying if
we're in
King
the
Richard?
We're living in the world of Finch, but the characters you have to pick to spend time with are from King Richard.
Not King Richard, that's for sure. I would get so annoyed so fast. Yeah. Probably like Serena or Venus, right? Because I'm like,
well, I think they're
you guys are athletes.
Young, they're athletes. But I think,
too young.
I think, I mean, just too young to, like, you'd have to take care of them, and I don't think I'd be equipped to do that. Because Serena's, like, 10, so it'd be like you would have a child.
Yeah.
And remember, tennis skills mean nothing in the apocalypse.
Well, they could hit things with their tennis rackets and, they're fit, is what I was saying. Like, they have the stamina to...
Well, they're fit for children, yes.
For children.
I mean, they're some of the most talented children that have ever lived, but tennis.
I would honestly want to be with the guy who did the drive-by, because clearly he has no issue killing people.
that is an absolutely off-the-wall response. Because I think he would have no issue killing you, Karsten.
That is... You're so right.
Now, in King Richard's defense... He is very driven, and he makes plans, and I think that could be valuable in the apocalypse.
Yeah, but at tennis, I don't think King Richard would be like, never mind, I don't know.
Richard, I think, has a lot of similarities to Finch as a character.
Yeah. King Richard built these girls, basically, you know.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Now,
anyway,
last question about this. Would you say that King Richard... And that, just one word answer. King Richard is closer to Finch or Jeff the robot?
Jeff, definitely.
I agree.
Because Finch is a very different person.
He's impulsive sometimes.
Yeah.
That's the thing.
Yeah.
King Richard is? There was a correct answer to that. King Richard is impulsive. Yeah.
Like, if you do the personality test, they're on the different... sides of the spectrum.
Jeff the robot and King Richard are similar, and objectively that was the right answer, and you passed the test.
Awesome. Well,
what else do you have to say about King Richard?
Not a lot. That's why I was like, we should I mean, the score, I was going to make a joke on Letterboxd. I don't know if you've seen National Treasure, but the score sounds identical to the National Treasure score.
Really? I actually watched National Treasure earlier this year.
Really?
We talked about this before. It's fun.
I love that movie. That and the sequel are both great.
Yeah. At the time, obviously hear the scores of films, but I never remember them after the film ends.
I think
it's very noteworthy, like Dune or something.
Yeah. I really like take note of them during the film. I think it's crazy to me
that you can be like, yeah, the score from King Richard reminds me of National Treasure. Like,
I don't know why.
And you thought I was crazy for comparing this film to Finch.
Now, I don't remember the Finch score. I don't think it had a score. It had American Pie 3 times.
It did have American Pie. Not... Do you think that they sold a Finch record? And like on the album, it just played. Finch. On the album, the track listing just has American Pie 3 times in a row.
Hank's version. That would have been a... Never mind. Okay, well, what are you feeling for a score with King Richard?
Like a 3.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, that's exactly what I was giving it. I was going to give it a 3. I was going to wrap it up just by giving my brief predictions for the awards.
Oh, that's a great segment idea.
Well, I'm just... Because this is obviously... This is the biggest lock of the year so far. I'm like, this will 100% be nominated for Best Picture. Will Smith honestly might win Best Actor. I think she'll get Best Actress as well, the mom. Not win, but like definitely nominated. And it'll get like production design because it's a period piece. Like, I don't know. I think it's going to be a big Oscar movie. But Trial of the Chicago 7, everyone thought that was going to be a big Oscar movie too. And it won like nothing. But yeah, I just think... I think Will Smith's definitely the front runner, unless I'm forgetting about someone. I don't know if it's going to take home Best Picture, though. We still haven't seen Belfast, and I heard that's the front runner there, but I don't know.
Yeah.
That's my thoughts. But, yeah.
Do you think your boy Timmy's going to get nominated?
Oh, for Dune? No. Yeah. No, there's not a chance. But... Dune is probably going to be nominated for Best Picture, is what I'm predicting. I do not anticipate it winning.
Bro, definitely I just want to say, I believed his hand was getting burned off when it was in that box. He made me believe it, and I don't believe things easily.
I don't know if you're messing with me, but I really liked that scene.
And that actually was a good scene.
I thought it was believable, and everyone keeps making fun of it. And I was like, I liked the Gom Jabbar scene.
It was funny. No, I mean, it was like, not funny, like, haha, but I mean, it was like... It was kind of good. Like, that scene, objectively on paper, is ridiculous.
Yeah.
Put your hand in the box. But it worked better than it should have worked. That's the thing. Exactly. They kind of pulled it off.
Totally. Totally.
So, King Richard.
King Richard. Yeah. Sweet. You can watch it on HBO Max, and it's also in theaters.
It is.
Yeah. When I looked this up, it was it's playing in theaters.
See it in theaters. No, you could see it on HBO Max. That's how I just watched it. That's...
Let's get into questions. We have some really good ones today. Honestly, I had to cut some other good ones because we had so many good ones, but we're gonna get to some of those. This first one comes from $15 patron Wiley Todd over on the Patreon, and it's, do you guys read books? If so, do you read any fantasy?
Just Wiley, we met at the last patron hangout on Zoom.
Yeah, nice guy. Yeah, that's a good
podcasting setup Wiley has.
Yeah, to say that if you are a patron, you get to participate in our Zoom hangouts and hang out with us. We get to compliment your podcasting setups. But yeah,
anyways, back to the question. So
do you read any books?
I don't read a lot of books.
Mm-hmm.
I have ADD, and it always historically when I was younger just made it really difficult to read books. So I just never got in the habit. I read a lot of short form journalism, I will say.
Yeah.
So that's the thing. I probably read, you know, the equivalent of 20 pages of various things a day, but I just don't, I never got into books because I just can't.
Yeah.
The idea of starting a book to me just feels kind of mentally overwhelming.
Yeah.
But yeah. I know, and the good news, Wiley, is your question is not in vain, because here to save the day as always, saving my day, saving your day is our resident Karstcast super reader.
Bookworm.
Bookworm. Yeah. Aficionado extraordinaire.
Yeah.
The one, the only, Karsten Rundquist.
I haven't read a book in like 4 months, but I have not. I'm in one of the worst ruts. I have not.
What about Dune?
I think I read Dune. Yeah, but
you
I didn't
read
even
all of
finish
it.
Dune.
You didn't finish it. I remember
finish Dune.
You had this whole philosophy before you saw Dune that you were telling me about. Where you're like, okay, so I read the first half, so I understand all the factions, and then I'm gonna watch the film and I'm gonna finish the second half. And it sounds like that did not happen.
It did. Well, no, what happened was I finished the second half via David Lynch's 1984 Dune. So I got a little bit of everything. And apparently, David Lynch's Dune is the worst way to experience the ending. So I really screwed myself over there.
Yeah, I'm skeptical that watching the second half of the other Dune is the equivalent to reading the second half of the book.
Yep.
So I haven't seen the other Dune. My understanding, though, is that they cram the entire book into one film.
Yep, and there's like a lot of book left, and they really cram it in there.
Yeah.
Now I haven't, you know, finished the book, so I can't entirely speak on that. But yeah, no, I'm not reading anything right now, actually. But I think come when I get back to Chicago, I'm gonna, you know, get more into reading now that Thanksgiving and a few of my video schedule stuff has calmed down. You know, crack open some books.
Yeah, you also had that book of like 50 short stories or something, or poems or something, whatever it was.
Yeah, it's actually back there on that big shelf. I got through
now,
one of those short stories.
I was about to say,
never.
I remember you got through one, and then you were like, you recommended the book in our recommendation segment.
It's because I was bored at the airport and was like, I need something. So they had that at one of those airport shops, and I bought it and read one in the airport while I was waiting for my flight. And I was like, this is pretty good. I have not opened the book since, but maybe I'll finish it. Maybe I will get through
that. You should make a video about it. You need to make a second channel where you review books instead of movies. And yeah. The only review on it is for 50 short stories.
Ranking every short story in 50 short stories.
And then also reviewing the first half of the Dune book.
Yeah, yeah.
And you give it a do not continue. Stop halfway. So, you know, anyone listening to this, if you're somehow still listening to this podcast, that is a free YouTube review style you can do, is you review the first half of books and tell people if it's worth finishing.
That's actually, you could do that with movies. I could honestly do that with,
I mean, that's with, already happened. Remember the Google review for Cry Macho?
Oh yeah, yeah.
So the guru or someone wrote like 36 minutes in, not sure yet.
Yeah, I was gonna say that my what I watched this month thing was actually based on a book YouTuber who did like what I read this month, which I think, first of all, is insane to have enough that you read each month that you can make videos like that.
Yeah.
I'm like, if I did that for my books, it would be one thing and it wouldn't be finished.
Yeah.
I'd be like, yeah, I read 50 pages of Dune. Yeah. Pretty good so far. And that's the video. Thanks for watching.
Yeah. Do you think, and this is the last thing I'll say about this, for April Fools, you'll do some kind of special video where it's like, oh, what I did blank this month.
Well, I do have an April Fools idea.
We can't reveal it.
I actually don't want to spoil it.
Yeah.
But it's in the vein of, all I'm saying is it's perfect that April Fools is the 1st of April. It's just, it's going to be good. It's going to be good.
Is it going to be what I April Fooled this month?
No.
Okay. Unfortunately. Well, I guess we should probably get to the next question.
Yeah, we should get to the next question.
So, we're sorry, Wiley, that we're not more avid readers.
Yeah. We do not read fantasy, I think, is except Dune is kind of fantasy. Yeah.
And the last book I read in totality was the fourth Harry Potter, and that's when the movies started coming out, so I said, screw this, and just started watching the movies.
That's the last book you've read?
Yeah, I was in middle school.
God,
that's the last book that I think I read something. Yeah, I know
you should pick up something.
Yes, I have not read a book in probably over 15 years.
Wow.
I think that I like had to read a couple books for high school.
Yeah,
but I never had to take any literature classes or English classes in college because I had like credit from AP classes.
Wow.
Yeah, so I never read any
books.
You did
so good in high school. All right. Well, this next question comes from Bloomer Jella, and it's: do you have any bad drunk stories? And also, what would you have liked to have studied, if not film and anthropology?
Ooh,
double whammy there. Wow.
So, I actually don't really have any bad drunk stories. Now,
no, you seem pretty put together I've seen you at events.
Yeah, I just don't drink a ton usually. I will say that when I was doing archaeology in the Bahamas one night, I did get really drunk and threw up like four times. And it was just outside in the Bahamas. There's like nothing around, right?
Yeah.
So it was just in the sand, so it wasn't really that big a deal.
Yeah.
My brother, though, used to get drunk, and he thought it was funny when he was drunk to get inside public trash cans, like on the, like, just on normal roads.
Yeah, I've seen those videos, and he pops out and scares people.
And he pops out like Oscar the Grouch or whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, weird guy.
Very weird guy. I think I've told this on the podcast, but my worst story was when I was at a party, and it was like well into the party, so I was like, I wasn't gone, but I was like feeling good. And then Lily from Beach Bunny walked in, and I was really into Beach Bunny at the time. I was like a big fan. Also like the drummer was there or something. And I am like the most tame person around people that I'm like a fan of, but that time I was like, she walked in and I like screamed. I was like, ah! And she like was freaked out, and I was like, I love your music, even the solo stuff. And it was just really, she was like, thanks.
Yeah, the thing that makes this funnier is that we're like, they're like a, you know, friend of a friend for both of us.
Yeah.
So you know a lot of people that are very close friends with them.
I have many mutuals. I mean, I've like talked to the guitarist many times.
Oh, I play Rocket League with him sometimes. Yeah.
Yeah, like all my friends play video games with him. He's like, you know, but Lily, I was like, I'm a huge fan. I was like starstruck.
Do people do that with you?
Some people are. Yeah, some people I notice are like genuinely taken aback and like. And I think it's weirder because I'm, like, not an actual famous person because...
Well, you're on famous birthdays. I mean, the birthday was wrong, but you're on there.
Yeah. I'm just some guy that they've seen a lot on the internet and on Twitter. And I feel like if you see someone like that in person, it's really, like, alarming.
Yeah. Honestly, like, whenever I see you in person, I'm very starstruck.
It's the same thing, yeah.
Because I never see you in person anymore.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah, but you're about to.
I'm about to.
And we're going
to
be at a Smash tournament together.
Oh yeah, we are.
Which I have to start training for.
I have not played Smash in over a year.
Yeah.
I did beat you though that one Smash tournament.
Yeah.
Like, and it was like the third time I'd ever played a Switch.
Next question is from Tingling 01, and it's thoughts on texting with lowercase letters. You know me. I don't know if you've noticed this, but I've been big into the lowercase thing.
Like, so I want to clarify this question. Are we saying this means instead of uppercase? So it's like, like everything's lowercase. So you don't like, because obviously normal words besides like the first letter of the sentence,
Yeah, it's all lowercase.
Yeah. So you just mean the first letter, you intentionally make it lowercase, even though your phone corrects its uppercase.
Yeah.
Yeah. See, that's
the thing. Can turn off
there's a mental game, because most people don't turn that off, and they still then will hit backspace and then make it lowercase, which requires way more effort. But the thing is that it looks more like chill. So it makes it look like you're being chill, but it actually requires more effort. And we all have kind of agreed on this.
Yes. Yeah, that is such a great point. Here's the thing. I think I'm not as big into the low. I mean, I do lowercase because I think it looks nicer. I'm like, I like a lowercase B more than a uppercase one. It just looks, like you said, chiller. But my thing is periods. I'm like, rarely will I put a period at the end of a post, because that you put a period and it's just like, this guy is the most serious person in the world. So I avoid periods very closely.
Now, I agree with you. I don't do a lot of tweets. I do like one tweet a week. But I a lot of times do lowercase, just because it does make it look like you're doing less effort, even though for me it's more effort because I don't have auto capitalization off.
Yeah.
And then I also don't add periods. But I think when I'm texting to people I know, I just do a lot of exclamation points, because that makes it sound like you're like having fun.
Yeah, yeah.
It's because you're trying to like be like, oh, like, no, like, we're cool. Like, because I feel if you're doing normal punctuation, it absolutely makes it feel this weird level of formality that I don't want to like put across to this person.
Yeah. Like, imagine ending a thing with a period to your friend. The friend would think you're pissed at them.
Yeah, like if I wrote, it's, oh, I'll see you tomorrow, period.
Yeah. Yeah.
That doesn't sound good. I don't want to see that person.
Mm-hmm. No, no. I'm like, that person's going to kill me.
Yeah.
You know? Okay, I'm glad we're on the same page about that. I do have a lot of thoughts on it. I do think more recently, though, I'm leaning out of the lowercase thing, because I think it's becoming more chill to just let the caps hang loose.
And we're actually in complete agreement, because I used to do that more, and I've done it less in the last like year or two.
Yeah, yeah.
I still don't add periods, though, because you're a psycho if you end a
Periods, it's a different game.
If it's a two-sentence text, you do a period after the first sentence, but you don't end it on a period. Yeah. That last period is pointless.
The last period does not need to be there.
Yeah.
Cool. We have one more today, and it's from I'll Marry the Borslow. And it's, what's one of your favorite pieces of internet culture? Could be anything from YouTube vids or memes to people like Nick Cage.
The
Cars Cast Movie Cast. That's got to be.
The Cars Cast Movie Cast, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think I personally enjoyed it a lot when people would write Karsten Rundquist moment.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. No, that's a good question, though. I think that personally, I don't like the pieces of internet culture that everyone is in on.
Yeah.
So I don't think it's like, for me, I don't like the Nick Cage stuff. It's just because it's too obvious. I like internet culture where the joke is only some people get it.
Yeah.
Which I guess feels exclusionary, but I think that it's because you have to be like deeper into the internet to understand.
It's because it doesn't feel like it's overplayed at that point.
Yeah.
Like the Nick Cage thing, it's like you can buy like a blanket with his face on it at like Walmart now, and it's like not funny. I'm like,
right,
the joke's over at this point. But yeah. Would you count Drill as internet culture?
Oh, absolutely.
Because he's like
the
full
most
blown
internet. Yeah.
Like New York Times article. Like he's popular, but it like is still very funny to me. Yeah. I like Drill.
Yeah. I like Drill, and when people reference, like, they quote tweet old Drill tweets that are applicable to a current situation.
Yeah.
Like the best one is the candle tweet.
What is, oh, the
budgeting
budget? Yeah. So funny.
Just when people find scenarios on Twitter to then quote tweet that tweet, it's always the best.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, for anyone that doesn't know, just very briefly, this is a Drill tweet from a few years ago where someone's like, help me budget my family is starving, and they do like a normal budget, and then in the middle of the budget it says like candles $700. It's like over half of the budget.
$700 is also such a funny number.
I don't
for
know
it.
If, was like, it 700? I don't remember. I was it was something it, like I, absurd.
It wasn't like enough, because it was, if it was like a million, the joke would be too obvious. Be but yeah, because it's just, it's like just
a number
a
you
little,
could spend on something.
Yeah, it's like way too much, but a realistic amount is so funny.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I also want to give a shout out to our friend of the podcast, and also my friend in real life, Dan White.
Yeah.
Dan has had some very good tweets that I feel like, you know, he's like have some sort of internet culture ability.
He's properly participated. I would agree. Yeah.
Yeah. He has some like tweets that hit like a million likes.
Yeah.
Like his
they
tweet
end up on
he,
like iFunny.
Yeah. Or he like cooks an apple in like a hot, like a crock pot or something.
Yeah.
Or like an Instapot.
I think I'm a fan of like, and these are like overplayed too, but like Adult Swim viral stuff. Mm-hmm. Like the Too Many Cooks thing, I still get a kick out of them. I like their stuff. And I feel like they're in the internet culture sphere. Anyway. I hope that answers that. And that's those are the questions.
Those are
lastly, because we should wrap it up here. Just realized
Carson
time,
has to go to
I got
a restaurant.
Dinner.
He has to leave in 10 minutes.
Yeah. Let's announce next week's movie. Next week, Jeff.
Yeah.
I actually was wondering if you want to do an episode with Jaxie.
Yeah.
We're gonna and she pitched Election as the movie.
Is that the Matthew Broderick?
Yes.
Yeah. Reese okay. Yeah. I've seen that like 10 years ago. Yeah, it's great.
One of my favorite comedies. It's an amazing film. If you're down,
I'm down.
I'm down. Awesome. So next week we're talking Election. I don't know where you can stream it. I
and
Googled Election.
You probably
not
get it from
get...
your local library.
Yeah. It's on Hulu.
Perfect.
So yeah, taking a break from recent releases to talk Election. And Jeff and I will have a lot of new stuff coming soon, because Jeff and I will be in person.
In the same place.
So yeah, that's that. Next, we'd like to read a review to encourage you guys to leave reviews. We're not ranked any. Well, we're number 192 in Norway on the TV and film charts.
That's
so good.
Good
for
us. That's probably all Vegard Strom.
Yep. this one comes from Luke M. Van from Germany. Subject line is Comfort Cast, 5 stars. And it reads, very entertaining, very random. Karsten and Jeff talk in a very comforting way. Honestly, feels like I'm almost part of the conversation. I hope this podcast will never end, and I hope the raw jokes never stop. Please. And then a heart emoji. Thank you, Luke.
A lot of raw emotion in that review.
And lastly, we want to thank the patrons. Remember those guys from the beginning?
I remember them.
If you want to become a patron, if you want to help out the pod and support us, if you're a consistent listener and want a ton of cool perks like hanging out with us every month, as well as extra Karstcast content, 2 bonus episodes a month, plus a huge back catalog of a bunch of old episodes.
Yeah, help Karsten pay for more of those Chicago Cubs hats.
Exactly. Yeah, because you know they're not cheap.
No, he's a real fan.
Big fan of the Cubs. The Karstcast Patreon is the best place to go. Patreon.com/Karstcast. You get exclusive access to bonus episodes, Q&As, shout-outs at the end of every episode, which we're about to do. You get your name read in the podcast. Immortalizes your internet presence and Zoom Hangouts. Anyway, thank you. Ainley Ames A. Richardson the First, Alex Thompson, Alex Thomas, Anson Contreras, Antonio DeMarco, Blake Root, Boat, Brandon U, Brock Schultz, Camilla Coop, David Sir, Eden, Gavin Gibson, Grant Gao, Harry Remedianakis, Iva J. Neeston, John Van Hout, Carson Dua Backflip, Katie T. Liv Rob, Lukewarm, Maddie Robertson, Martin Duff, Mary Lee Borslow, Meridian Mount, Monopoly Shrimp on the Barbie, Monroe Page, Nora B., Riley Off, Sophia Arrieta, Stella Perry, Supercalifragilistic, XBLodocious, Smitty Werbin, Jagerman Jensen, Tobias Broke, Tom Lakes Beans, Vegard Strom, Wes Kinley, Wiley Todd, Xavier Fossier, Yusef A., Zoinks, and Zoe Hernandez McDonald. Thanks, guys. Zoinks really thought they were going to get it.
Yeah, it was very close.
The thing about Zoe is that I think because the E is Zoe with the two dots at the top, it's like at the end of the alphabet, so you can't just do Zoinks.
That is... Actually, you know, you learn something new on this podcast.
Well, I learned that in the moment. I was like, wait, this doesn't make sense because Zoe should be before Zoinks.
Yeah, but it's like an umlaut or something.
Yeah. Anyway, though, that is the podcast. I'm going to go celebrate my mom's birthday dinner.
Happy birthday to Karsten's mom.
All right, Jeff, do you have anything else you want to add?
Well, you know, I'm going to let you go, Karsten. You got to... have birthday dinner with your mom. So catch you on the flip side.
Catch you on the flip side.